Good evening. Welcome to another edition of the London Indie Underground, London's only independent music podcast showcasing some of various most talented artists, bands, and personalities. And I'm very excited to welcome back my buddy, your friend, the skinny fat guy. Gary, how are you?
Not sick.
You kind of still are a little bit,
though. Still a little bit. Nothing compared to last week. Fuck that. That sucked.
Missed you on Saturday, buddy.
Yeah, I watched the whole thing, though. Like a complete freaking nerd. Sitting at home watching it on screen going like, wow, why am I not there?
It was a lot of fun, dude.
Yeah.
It was a lot of fun. Now, this past weekend on Saturday, we did an ugly Christmas sweater party with the Creekside Strays here at the Vault Recording Studio at Adelaide and Princess. People donned their ugliest and came on down and celebrated some Christmas cheer and enjoyed some great music from the Creekside Strays. We recorded the podcast. I'm sure we'll be uploading it at some point, reviewing the material, too, as part of a pre-production for their new album that's coming. And, you know, we missed you, Gary, but hopefully we'll get you out of the next one. Glad to hear you're doing a bit better.
You know what? Next time, I'll wear the ugly Christmas sweater to whatever party.
Deal.
I was pissed. Nobody had the Slayer sweater. Nobody had the Descendants Christmas sweater.
Like, I was really hoping somebody did. I posted up. If somebody showed up in that, there was an extra special prize.
I know. I was like, and the funny part was I saw the Slayer one because every year, like, I go back home to Oshawa, and we go to this big family event on Christmas Eve, and all my family's there. And as soon as I saw the Slayer Christmas sweater, I wanted to buy it just to wear it to this, like, thing, right? Because they're all like, you know, oh, no, you know.
Did you – I don't know if we posted up. I think Jason's in the midst right now. Jason Rode, our photographer, is currently uploading some of the pictures to our page from the podcast. They can't see it. We don't have a camera. He's waving at the air, but he'll be posting up some photos. And I do believe there is a picture – of the winning, actually it turned out to be a vest. It wasn't actually a sweater. You didn't?
Oh. Man. Did the girl with the green pants win anything?
No. Honorable mention, though.
Honorable mention. Okay.
Yeah.
That's good.
That's what she got.
She should get honorable mention. Because it was funny because I was sitting and it was like the camera in the corner. So it was basically the one that was behind Jeremy kind of thing. Over, I'm pointing to it like anybody can see what the hell's going on. But anyways. And all I could see was these like sparkling green pants on this girl just sitting there like swinging her legs to the music. And I was just like, it's like, what the, and then I think Sarah ended up giving her a shout out.
Right. She looked like a Christmas ornament.
That's right.
Yeah. Her name was Barbie.
Oh, okay.
Real name. She's awesome, by the way.
Yeah. Well, to wear green pants like that, I guess you have to be awesome.
Yeah. You would have to be.
I'm not awesome, so I'm not wearing green pants.
All right. Well, this week, I'm very pleased to be joined by a couple of special guests. One of them is a repeat guest, Mr. Brandon Eady.
What up?
How are you?
I'm good, man.
Thanks for joining us today. And the other first-time guest on our show, hopefully not the last, Mr. Josh Torrance of Baptized in Blood. Josh, how are you?
I'm great, thank you.
Excellent, man. Awesome, awesome.
Is that RJ on guitar on the your intro music?
That was, no, that's Dave Zimba.
That's Dave.
The Salads.
Okay.
Yeah, so they did, as a matter of fact, our intro song, the lyrics for it, there is vocals and recorded by Mr. D. But it says London Indie Underground with your host, Sarah. So I tend to play that one just when we do the live events.
We can call you Sarah.
You could.
Hello, Sarah.
Hello. Speaking of Sarah Burke.
Sarah Janes.
I think she might be listening right now. Sarah was actually going to be joining us tonight. She was going to come down.
A cop out.
She's not feeling well. She actually had to take the day off of work.
Because she was hungover.
She's not feeling well. I know what she's doing. She's watching Dave Grohl on TV tonight.
I sent her a text on Sunday about coming out for beers, and she was already half-cocked at 6 o'clock in the afternoon.
She's a pro. Like, you could just tell she's a pro at it.
You know what? I've seen Sarah pretty twisted, and then the next day she went in, didn't miss a step, so... I don't know about that, but they ripped on her, I think, all day on the station, so...
Oh, really?
She's probably...
And
she's
what time is it right now? A little after 7?
Yeah. A little after 7.
At about 7:30, she's going to be laying on her couch, watching Dave Grohl on TV with her hands underneath her blanket.
Probably. As a matter of fact, she just sent me a text message. She recorded a little promo for us that I'm going to play in a little bit.
Nice.
I don't know if it's an apology for not being here or whatever the case may be, but... she texted me earlier today, apologized that she wasn't going to come down. She was still feeling under the weather. So
yeah, because she built it up, right?
Well, I was supposed to be here on Saturday, and I wasn't. So.
Yeah, what happened to you?
I was at home drinking Coors Light and playing Worms Revolution.
That sounds like a much better night.
It was awesome.
Dude, we had a clam tub full of beer. Today's unofficial sponsor.
Clam tub.
unofficial sponsor of today's podcast, Pabst Blue Ribbon.
Yeah, you're drinking Labatt's Blue.
Yeah.
Mm-mm.
The good stuff.
He is. I'm drinking the good stuff, but I have a fridge full.
Nice.
Remnants of the
I
podcast.
Was wondering how that worked out. Like how you were able to get that, because I know you're saying that there's going to be some free
Well, beer. You know, when people leave it behind, that's my sponsor.
There you go. Nice.
I can roll with that.
Mm-hmm.
So we got lots to talk about today. There's a lot in the news, some pretty crazy stuff, and some very cool stuff at the same time we're going to get to. Having said that, we're going to get to some music, and I'm going to start this baby off with a bit of shameless self-promotion. I'm going to spin one of my band songs. I play in a band called Surrounded by Water, some of you might be familiar. And this is a track, actually, that's going to be featured on the Brightside Records compilation. It's going to be coming out shortly, with featuring a bunch of London bands and area. Mr. Siegfried Meyer was the one who hooked it up out from Beach Road Studios and was gracious to ask us to be a part of it. And this was the track that we re-recorded at Beach Road Studios. So this is Surrounded by Water with Oblivious on the London Indie Underground.
Now pitch our pain for what's to come. Lay down waiting under the sun.
Surrounded by Water with Oblivious here on the London Indie Underground. Just kind of a side note for today's podcast, you know, we are going to be featuring some of the heavier stuff with Baptized in Blood being our indie spotlight band. So, you know, we try to tailor the podcast so that it kind of flows with some of the other music, but I'm sure we can dig into the archives here and pull out a couple of new numbers for you. Ones that you haven't heard, just want to thank the bands that continue to support us and send us in tracks here. You know, obviously we're nothing without your songs. Without your songs, we're just a bunch of dudes talking shit, really. So please continue to send in your tracks. We're going to support you. If you happen to be a band, you're listening in for the first time, and you'd like to get at us, obviously on Twitter, and you can see the links that are on your screen right now. But apart from that, you can send us an email of your MP3s or two to londonindieug@hotmail.com. and we're happy to play it for you. We do not discriminate, but do appreciate that we do have a pretty sizable catalog, and we do try to get to all the music, but we do have to spread it out a little bit, so bear with us. We will get to your music. And if you'd like to check out our past archives, too, of our previous weeks, we've had some great guests on. I encourage you to check them out. YouTube.com/LondonIndieUG. I believe there's 13 previous streams. This is the 14th week, and we keep growing and growing. So thank you so much for your support. We really appreciate it. So to kind of switch gears here, we alluded to a little while ago about a performance that's happening tonight. So Sandy Relief is a big deal. There's a big concert that's happening. And I understand that Nirvana, or the remnants of, are reuniting with Paul McCartney.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we've heard.
That's awesome.
Now, here's what I don't understand. Is Paul McCartney going to be playing bass?
Oh, no. He's the singer.
He will left-handed,
be
right?
And he's playing guitar.
And yeah, I guess.
I need to see this.
It's just taking Kurt's role altogether.
But this is the thing, though, is they're not actually playing Nirvana songs. They're playing songs that they have written within the last 2 weeks.
See, that's even more interesting.
I think that's incredible.
Absolutely.
I would actually wonder what it would be like trying to write a song with McCartney. You know what I mean? Like, would he just, like, basically say, yeah, fuck you.
See, 20 years ago with that band of McCartney, I don't think it would work at all.
Yeah.
But nowadays, I think that's, I don't know. He's a knight, like.
Right, yeah. Here's how songwriting goes. All right, Paul, let's write a song. All right, I've got a song here that we're going to play. Okay, and we're done writing.
Yeah.
Like, he would just show up with stuff, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
No, Paul, I'm not so sure about that bridge over there. Yeah. I mean, I know you've got, $100 million from all of your songs, but seriously, I mean, that bridge is kind of weak. Yeah, let's do this instead.
Yeah. Is it okay if I just call you Paul, or do I still keep calling you Sir Paul? Because this is getting kind of, retarded.
When he was knighted, does that give him, permission to, like, fence and lance people?
Just carry a sword around with
you. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I think the coolest part about it, though, is that it's Dave Grohl, Chris Novoselic, and Pat Smear.
Yeah.
And they haven't been on the stage together in like 20 years.
Oh, well, there you go. That's where the guitar's going to come in then.
Yeah.
Pat will fill that in.
Yeah.
And maybe Paul will play some piano or something.
What if I was to do this riff? No. That's the entire jam session right there.
There's other cool... Eddie Vedder from Pearl Jam is performing with... who is it? I'm going to have to look that up. But no, he's performing with someone else that's kind of odd. Rolling Stones are playing.
David Lee Roth?
Maybe.
Is it DLR?
I think
no,
Taylor
I'm just
Swift.
Asking. You said something kind of
Taylor Swift
weird.
Will be gating everybody.
Gary, if you can pull it, if you can find the information pretending.
Kanye is playing too, but he'll probably get up on the stage and take the moment away from Sir McCartney.
Oh, probably. So, you know what's interesting is that we were talking offline. So Paul McCartney wasn't familiar with Nirvana or their works.
What I read was his quote was, Dave Grohl called him up and asked if he wanted to come jam with some mates. He then looked at the guys and was like, you guys are really excited about, getting back together and playing. You really haven't been playing this whole time? Like, with a question? And one of his friends whispered at him, he's like, yo, man, that's Nirvana. I think you're Kurt Cobain now.
and ironically...
Wait, who's Kurt Cobain?
Paul McCartney.
No, is that what Paul McCartney said?
Yeah,
who's that's
at that point?
Probably. I am Kurt Cobain.
And then the other
Kurt
side
Cobag.
Of it.
Kurt Cobain.
And then our generation, or I shouldn't say our generation, but Y generation or whatever, doesn't even really know who the Beatles
like the
are.
Generation.
I met, so in this building, we talked about this previously, there's 35 jam rooms out here. I'm out front and I'm wearing a Beatles t-shirt. Some guy asked me, so here, what are these Beatles like? I heard about them before.
Well, they're shelled bugs that...
I didn't even know what to say. I'm like, are you kidding? You're joking, right? No, no. I'm like, man, you don't know who the Beatles are? What the fuck is wrong with you, man?
Well, was it the Billboard Awards or the MTV Awards where Paul McCartney actually played and then zillions of little children went on and were like...
Who's that old guy?
I mean, Justin Bieber.
Yeah, who hired somebody's grandpa to play the show?
Well, that's what happened with, recently with Billy Joe with Green Day, right? Green Day got the bums rush off the stage quick so they could get Justin Bieber out.
That was probably the best freak out I've ever seen. Yeah. And so, like, I don't know, I thought that was so well warranted.
Yeah, oh, completely, but it's just like, but it's just funny because it's like he's just saying what everybody else is thinking, right? Like, like
fucking Green Day. Yeah. I'm older than that kid.
Yeah.
My career's older than that kid.
Yeah. It's like, but he just snapped, eh? It was just awesome to watch. But it's the same thing, you know. It's like, who the fuck are these guys? Let's get them out of here because Justin Bieber's going to come out.
Have you heard his new album or their new album?
New albums.
New albums. There's three of them. Rather, yeah. So, pardon me.
Yeah, let's get it
pardon
right.
Pardon me. The last new record I heard was Dookie.
Yeah, same here. There's a band that, you know, just needs to stop.
I give them credit for what they're doing.
Again and again and again.
Yeah, but I mean, I don't know.
If they want to play their back catalog, which is what people really want to hear, and I mean, maybe, you know, some cuts off of the, you know, that, what was the other album there with the
American Idiot?
Yeah, American Idiot. There's, I mean,
which they turn into a Broadway play, so that's so punk.
Bizarre.
Yeah. Musica.
Bizarre. You know, if you want to support your back catalog, I get it, but, you know, at some point, you know, do you think, you know, maybe it's time we, you know, hang it up. Hang up the gloves, you know? Do we keep playing, or you almost become like a parody of yourself?
You know? Maybe they really enjoy playing these new songs.
Maybe.
Yeah, because I think American Idiot, they said they really did enjoy it. And it was interesting to read about how they wrote the album, because they just...
That was pretty cool.
They were never in the album. They were never in the studio at the same time. They would just each come in and jam something out, and then the other one would come in and add on to it. And then the other one come in later
and just
add on.
Build and build.
Yeah, until finally they had a bunch of songs. And I thought that was kind of a neat idea.
Yeah, that's kind of neat.
But at the same time, it's funny because even from like the early like Kerplunk and the Slappy Hours EPs, the sound has never changed. Like the formula has never changed.
No.
And even the more money they get to record, for some reason, it still sounds like
it just gets safer and more accessible, but it sounds the exact same.
Yeah,
right. That's an exact, you know, you communicated that exactly. Mm-hmm. Very safe songs. And, you know, I mean, the punk element is just not the same. You know what I mean? Like, I remember they were hardly
air quote punk to begin with.
Yes, but in the earlier days, I mean, their sound kind of defied that, you know, the conventional, if you will.
Have you watched the documentary 1994?
No.
It's, was it 1994 or 1992? No, 1994. And it's basically like Bouncing Souls, Blink-182, NoFX, Offspring, and all just talking about, you know, the growth and history of, like, that era of skate and pop punk.
I'll have to check it out.
Yeah. And how not Bouncing Souls, Pennywise. And how Pennywise single-handedly took Blink-182, Green Day, Offspring, all those bands, they took them on tour and built them up, and then they became massive, where Pennywise still stayed in their punk rock icon plateau.
Yeah, I was saying with Big Drill Car, like in the beginning, like they took everybody on tour with them to help them out, and then as everybody grew up and everybody got big and they all exploded, nobody basically lent a hand to bring back Big Drill Car after all they did for everybody else. So they ended up just saying, ah, fuck it, we're done.
I would still rather hear a new Green Day record than a new Blink-182 record, though.
Yeah.
Hear, hear.
And I love Blink-182.
There's a lot of people that would disagree with that.
Yeah, I know. Everyone loved that last record, and I use it as a coaster.
I didn't mind the side projects. Angels and Airwaves,
I hate Angels and Airwaves,
really?
Too. I loved...
Plus 44.
Thank you. Yeah, they were sweet.
What about Boxcar Racer?
Yeah, I like Boxcar. I thought it was just
something about Angels and Airwaves where he just got all emo.
I think it was the sound of the album.
Quote unquote emo.
It was. Yeah. It was like he was just tapping into the Cure's back catalog, really, and putting like a Blink-182 kind of like sound to it, right? But I didn't mind the tone. Like it's got a good mood for the album itself. I didn't mind it, but the Boxcar
Racer
album was
great. I just
thought awesome.
I just thought the songs were really, really subpar.
Yeah.
See, I never got into it. I was never into the Blink-182. I don't know. It was just too it was too upbeat for me. I was like a depressed 90s kid, right? So it was like Smashing Pumpkins and all that early stuff, right? Yeah.
That's why you're in a helmet cover band.
Yeah, exactly. Which, there's another band, Helmet. So, I mean, they keep coming out with new stuff.
And nobody has any idea who they are anymore.
No. Yeah. No, they don't. And, you know, the Monochrome, their last album, was, in my opinion, the closest sound to their original sound from, you know, from the first releases. And they had this prodigy drummer that was just like John Stainer. But it's nowadays it's really obscured. But back then it was like really cutting edge because nobody else was really doing that type of hardcore sound.
Mm-hmm.
But now they're, you know, you go to a Helmet show, and I've been to some, and people are kind of standing around going, okay, well, what's this song? I have no idea what's happening right now. And everybody's just waiting for, like, Milquetoast.
It's because they don't know that they've had, like, three records since the last time they saw
Exactly. Yeah. Well, on that note, we should get to some more music here. So I'm going to spin a band, Searching for Satellites. I played them before. I had spun their new single a couple of weeks back, but I'm going to take a cut off of their previous EP, which this particular track is called Bottom of the Ninth, Searching for Satellites in London Indie Underground. Searching for Satellites here on the London Indie Underground. So during the break, had a bit of an accident. Edie?
My glasses are in two.
I'm laughing with you. But seriously, he just takes off his glasses to clean them. Snaps right in half.
No pressure. I'm just too strong. I'm too strong for these glasses.
You need to bring back the monocle.
I can't even keep it up on my nose.
Dude, tonight.
I can't even see shit. I can see, yeah. I'm better vision without them on because they keep falling into my eyes.
At least later on when you go out, when one fogs up, you can just take it off and put the other one on.
Do you not have contacts?
I have a fear of putting things in my eye.
Really?
Yeah, I've tried with them before. It just doesn't work. My eyes close. Actually, one time when we were on a tour, remember that time I had pink eye? And we were in the van, and I was trying to put drops in my eye. Yeah, I got pink eye. And we were on tour.
Did you get it from the backseat of the van?
Probably.
Wow.
But yeah, I can't even put eye drops in my eye. Like,
the first time I got contacts, it felt like a real sped. Like, I couldn't. It was really difficult to put anything into my eye. Like, it was really awkward. Even the girl that was trying to help me was, like, almost laughing at me. But then after a while, you know, you kind of get used to it. You should try them out sometime. That way you won't break your glasses.
Well, I mean, I didn't used to have to worry because my mom was an optometrist and I got free ones.
Was. Do you think that'll be covered?
Well, I mean, I've only had them for, like, 5 months. I don't know how warranties work for glasses.
They should, like, for 5 months, then they should be totally covered.
Because that's a clean, like, a clean, straight half.
Yeah,
in half.
It wasn't like you were putting any pressure on him or anything.
It's just too strong.
Accidents happen, man. You know your own strength.
All those reps at Coors.
You know what else is strong? That voice of Donnie Tours.
Yeah.
So.
I don't know where you were going with that.
Where are we going with that, Josh?
That's it.
That's all you got?
Oh, he was talking about how Donnie Tour is no longer in Searching for Satellites. As the vocalist.
Oh,
I think that's where he was
going to say that.
Oh, well, he's not.
No, we talked about it previous weeks, yeah. And so they picked up a new singer.
Because we said so. You're out, Don Tour.
Hit the road, Jack. Yes, they do have a new singer.
Is it public knowledge?
No, it is not public knowledge.
Okay, fair enough.
It will be shortly.
Okay, good.
We'll keep it at that. So look forward to a lovely little return for
their
Satellites.
Their new CD just dropped, right?
Yeah.
So, I would assume then there's probably some plans to follow that up with a tour.
Absolutely. Good. There's no slowing this band down. So.
Good, good. Well, that's what you want to hear, right? I mean, members come and go, but show must go on. Mm-hmm. Some interesting news recently. I know you probably saw, you know, any one of many articles, because this was everywhere for a time. You guys heard of the IKEA monkey?
Mm-hmm.
Did you see
Darwin,
the story?
Darwin the IKEA monkey.
So the story goes, because initially when I saw the article, I see this monkey, and I thought that it was just kind of running loose in IKEA.
Oh, yeah.
But it turns out somebody had left it in their vehicle.
I had no idea what was going on other than the headlines from Twitter, AM980, and whatever.
Yeah. So somebody left it in their vehicle.
In a crate. She had it crated in her vehicle.
Why did she have a monkey in a crate in her vehicle? At IKEA.
Really? Why don't we all have monkeys and crates in our vehicles?
Fair.
At IKEA.
All right, at IKEA.
Yeah. No, she's had this monkey for years, and she takes it everywhere. She snuck it into the CNE last year. she's tried to take it into IKEA before, but they told her, hey, no pets. So basically no monkeys, I guess. So she left it in the crate in the car, and it's a monkey, so obviously he got out and... They found him roaming around the parking lot, and to make matters worse, he's dressed in human clothes, wearing a little Sherpa coat, so that makes him more adorable to every female out there, and somebody finds it, and they make a big stink about it. And
So he gets out of the crate?
Yeah, he gets out of the crate, then out of the car, and then
it's
he's
a
just...
crafty monkey.
Yeah. Then
and then he masturbates and gives everyone the finger at the same time.
And then throws shit out.
Yeah, then just throws feces on everybody. Yeah, and then so they find him, and everybody's like, oh my goodness, it's a monkey, or whatever what they would have said. And and people take pictures because we're in that modern society where every iPhone and every phone has a camera, and they get posted. And next thing you know, he becomes the biggest news.
Right.
You know, hey everybody, the president's been killed. Look at the IKEA monkey.
Yeah. Oh, there's memes all over the place too. Yeah. And people are substituting like Rob Ford's face on it.
Yeah.
It was pretty great.
Yeah, I saw the one. Did you guys see the woman that? The woman that basically redid the great piece of artwork, she basically brought it back to life. There was this woman, never had an art class in her life, and they had this like this beautiful old fresco painting in this church, and she volunteered to redo it because it was like the worst thing ever. It went from basically being this very stupid for words today, but very detailed painting of this monk to all of a sudden this big blob looking thing, right? And it was like so funny, but of course, what do I see today? But the three stages with the original, then the blob, and then the remake, and it now has the monkey's
Darwin
face on
the monkey.
It. Yeah, Darwin the monkey. So yeah, it's just, I don't get it, but whatever.
So the monkey's been confiscated?
Yeah, the monkey is now in Toronto at the Humane Society, and he's going to some special place because he was on the endangered or prohibited pets list. So
this reminds me of an episode of Friends.
It's so true. I never thought of that.
A couple years back, correct me if I'm wrong, but Was there not like some kind of Bengal tiger scare, like out of Strathroy or something? Somebody has some exotic animals in Strathroy, and one of them was a Bengal tiger
that
got out.
Did it eat a kid?
I don't know about that, but I know it came into London. I think Ajay's here.
Oh, okay.
Quite possibly.
Is that or it's a Bengal tiger?
We do have an open door policy here at the London.
It's Ajay. Tape, I broke my glasses.
Yes.
Ajay, the Bengal tiger.
How are you? Hair's looking fantastic, buddy.
Hey, how's it going?
Feeling better, man?
Yeah, I'm feeling much better. Thank you.
So we should get to some more music here. I'm going to spin a track from a band called Headstrong featuring our friend Joel Crass. Mm. We're hoping to have Joel back on again because he keeps coming around these parts and bringing beer and chicken. We love him, so we continue to support him. If you've not checked out this band, they're dating back now, I think, early 2000s. A band that originally came out of the London area, signed to RCA Records. Went on to make some noise and kind of come full circle. But this particular album was their release on RCA Records. And this song actually was the song that started it all for them. A number of years ago, there was a program called Farm Club, which was internet-based. And through fan voting, they would showcase up-and-comers. And one of those up-and-comers happened to be a band called Bomb 32, which turned into Headstrong. So this is All of the Above by Headstrong, London Indie Underground.
Taskmaster made. This is the alligator Florida Everglade. This is the mess of material excess, stood up and strong in a full court like press. And when the storm turns the deck to splinters, and when the mass has like snow in winter, when the boat won't float and you're in the sea's clutch, that's when I guarantee you that nothing ever felt like so much. We hold these truths for to be self-evident, and anyone who isn't with us wouldn't understand us. We're not intent on the fall of the government. We're not intent. Was common practice. There was a time when any child could hack this. There was a time when the people left singing of the perils of the pit and the pendulum swinging. Here's anything to read to help with your thinking. Here's anything to hold to keep you from sinking. Here's two times the work in one half the time, and everything you need is calcium, lust, and rhyme. We only choose for to be self-evident, and anyone who isn't with us wouldn't understand us. We're not intent on the fall.
All of
Headstrong with All of the Above here on the London Indie Underground. Ajay, you were saying I should have teed up the little Joel Crass clip that he recorded us for us. All these promos. Incidentally, if you happen to be in a band and we featured your band on our podcast and you'd like to cut a little promo for us, we're not asking bands to do this just so we could tee up your songs. And we've had a number of submissions, but if you'd like to cut one for us, it's really easy to do, really. If you just grab your iPhone or your smartphone or whatever, use your voice recorder, say, hey, this is so-and-so from this band, you're listening to London Indie Underground, send it to us in an email. We'll be happy to use it to tee up your music for you. And we appreciate it the same
time. We should be doing them as well. This is Gary from London Indie Underground. You're listening to London Indie Underground.
You just did one.
There you go.
There you go. Good job.
Now we can play my tracks.
Did you bring any music for us this weekend?
No, not this week.
No?
No, it's funny, right? Because I keep asking guys, and they're just, I don't know if it's this, again, we're just discussing it, the schwa thing. Lazy. Like, you know, like, yeah, we'll gladly, yeah, get on. Yeah, no. And it's like, nothing. So, hey, whatever. We got so many bands out here to play anyways.
It's true.
But we'll keep going.
Heard some interesting news, actually.
What's that? About a monkey in IKEA?
That too. No, about Ben the Salads,
yep,
who played with us on our inaugural podcast, and they just had a new album drop. And it looks like, now I don't know, it's not a confirmed report, but Darren Pfeiffer, their drummer, may be going back to L.A., and their old drummer, Grant Taylor, might be stepping back in.
Oh, nice.
Which is amazing.
I thought it was pretty confirmed.
Well...
Yeah, because I've actually...
Until they posted up.
Yeah. I'm the one who brought it up to you.
Yes, but I talked to Chuck about it.
I know.
And it's interesting because yeah, not being in the scene at all, and I already heard that Pfeiffer has been going back and forth to L.A. recording.
Right.
So...
Is he doing some Goldfinger?
Yeah, that's what I've heard.
No.
Goldfinger's done.
They're done?
They are done.
He's okay. Out.
He's out.
Feldy.
Feldy is a crazy... Yeah.
So Feldy kicked everybody out. The founding members of the band kicked them all out. Hired a new group of kids.
So Guns N' Roses.
They learned the song in 6 days,
mm-hmm,
and went on tour of us, Australian tour.
They're not wearing KFC buckets, though. They're all wearing Happy Meal buckets.
Yeah,
like baskets over their faces.
Can you imagine? I mean, you're a founding member of the band. Now I get it. You know, he's the songwriter or whatever. But still, man, he was in that thing right from the beginning. And Pfeiffer has become part, you know, synonymous with Goldfinger.
Oh, he
shows,
was
right?
The... I don't want to... Yeah.
Yeah, the tweet... Yeah. So, those listeners that don't know, the band Goldfinger was like a... kind of revolutionized the ska sound in some respects. Yep. It was back in the 2000s, right? And one of their shticks was their drummer, Darren Pfeiffer, who now plays with the Salads, or may not be playing with the Salads, would put a Twinkie between his butt cheeks... And they would invite a lucky fan at the show attending to come up on stage and have a bite of said Twinkie.
You make it sound so nice. Like, hey, come on over to my mom's house for dinner.
We're having Twinkies.
She's
with my butthole.
Roast beef.
Delectable.
Was it after the show, too? Like, after you played?
It's no. In his sweaty ass crack.
Yeah. Seeped inside that Twinkie.
It was at some point during the set, for sure.
And those are sponges.
Yeah. And then he would play the Wayne Gretzky song. Which Darren Pfeiffer proclaims that Wayne Gretzky is the only man that he would have sex with.
Fact.
Do you think they'd still do that now that you see Twinkies on eBay for like 350 grand?
Yeah.
This Twinkie was in Darren Pfeiffer's ass.
No, it's because there's going to be a shortage.
Yeah, they've.
It's true.
Yep. To move to logs, you know, coconut.
What I don't understand is what are we all going to eat after next week, after the world ends and we can't get Twinkies?
Man, that just fried my
blew
brain.
Your mind.
Blew my mind.
Wagon wheels, ho-hos, ding-dongs.
Joe Louis.
Joe Louis.
What were those?
What
were those pink ones?
Yeah, yeah, flakies.
Oh, passion flakies were the shit.
Yeah.
Logs?
Yeah. the coconut.
Yeah.
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 Those are amazing.
I thought they were called snowballs.
No, snowballs are different.
Oh, okay, yeah. Okay.
The log.
Okay. There we go.
There was the half loons.
Yeah.
Cupcakes.
Those are good.
Yeah, but those are all Vachon, aren't
ho-hos?
They? Are they not? Or
man,
they
if we were talking, if we, yeah, if people didn't hear us talking about Hostess, I don't know what the fuck they think we're talking about right now.
Exactly.
Man, check out those ho-hos and yoo-hoos. I got a sweet log in my lunch pail.
Let's get a snowball.
Meow, what's coming up next?
What is coming up next? I'm going to play some more music. Actually, I'm going to play a band. We featured them before. Members of this band are also in members of Divine Right of Kings, which just played a show, I believe, this past Monday with Skynet.
Yeah, in Toronto, the Bovine.
Bovine, and did they not play
here? They played
here?
Call the Office.
They played Sunday. Oh, yeah, they played Sunday at the Bovine, and then Monday they played at Call the Office.
Oh.
With Skynet. They were asked to do the show because of the one that they did on Sunday. So they asked them, hey, do you guys want to open up for us in London? They're like, do we? So I guess they were really happy with the show. But
don't we?
Got some tracks here that we recorded. I'm going to feature for you. So this is a song, a bit of a long number, but I hope you dig it. It's called Alice by Ghostship Victoria, London Indie Underground.
Thank you.
Ghostship Victoria in London, Indie Underground. Thanks for your patience. Had a bit of a safety meeting here. So we're going to do the Indie Spotlight. Everybody's just rolling in.
Smoke break.
And everybody's laughing.
Smoke break.
I don't know
break.
How long we were out, but sorry to keep you waiting. You know, these things happen.
I can't see my watch anyways.
I mean, we're not pro. Yeah.
I don't have a watch.
Yeah. Edie was responsible for letting us know when we were back. Patty's got busted
glasses.
What's
happening?
What's up?
What's going on?
Gary, where's my Merkin shirt? Pardon? It's a legitimate question.
Where's your Merkin shirt?
Yeah.
Well, I said we'd have him for when Sig came in.
Siggy. I know Siggy's probably listening right now. He's been listening. He's working on some new Staylefish, actually. I just sent him 3 new tracks to mastering.
That's right.
One more to go, and then the album is done. Oh, boy. It's about time.
Oh, boy.
You know, we've really been taking our time with this thing. We wanted to make sure that it was perfect and kind of an unconventional recording because, you know, the songs came in and were more or less formed in the studio. So when that happens, I mean, you record stuff, you listen back, and you want to make some changes here and there. But it's been well worth the wait. Believe me, and the last track that we were working on today, it's called Atterberg Limit. I can't wait to get this thing to you. It's just huge. So many different tones in it. It's just layered. It's got Mellotron. there's so many instruments, and I think it's 163 channels of audio, including samples.
Wow.
It's crazy.
In one song?
In one song, yeah. I've never had so many channels of audio in one song before.
Were you guys recording it like the way Billy Talent does with like each string?
Yeah, pretty much. Pretty much, yeah. There's... I lost count of how many guitar tracks there are on it, but there's just so many layers, and it sounds huge. I can't wait to get it to you, and we're definitely going to showcase that. As a matter of fact, Sarah Burke was nice enough to come down and to record a album premiere podcast with us last week for Staylefish, and we are going to be premiering that. We'll be making an announcement shortly, so make sure you check our Twitter and Facebook, and we'll be premiering the album front to back with some commentary in between each song to give you a little bit of history, where the songs came from, so on and so forth. So looking forward to that. And in a little bit, too, we're going to be getting to this message here from Sarah Burke that she sent to us as to the reason why she couldn't be here today. I'm curious. I haven't even listened to it yet. I got the confirmation while we were broadcasting, so we'll have to check this out. All right, so it's Indie Spotlight time. So today we're going to be featuring some new tracks from Baptized in Blood. And Josh, a couple of questions before we get to some music. So, you know, I know a lot of our listeners may be familiar with your band, but those that aren't, because we do have listeners, you know, from out of town and other parts. So Baptized, you guys have been around here for a long time. When did you start up?
We've been going hard since the end of 2004. So what's that, 8 years now?
And has it been that lineup since?
We've had a lot of changes over the years, but it's been the same lineup now for the past probably 5 years, which has been really solid.
Excellent.
Got 5 guys that love playing together and touring together.
You were one of those bands that I kind of watched start from, you know, I remember the beginning and seeing your shows. I mean, you guys played at the Embassy, Call the Office, and, you know, watching your local crowd kind of grow. And it was, for you guys, it was one of those word of mouth bands because, you know, nowadays we have social media and all that stuff that you can really put your stuff out there. But back in those days, I mean, we were just on the cusp of some of that. So it was, you know, postering and word of mouth was, for me anyways, which was I saw what really helped your band grow.
Definitely.
So yeah. When was it that, you know, you guys did some touring extensively and then ended up signing to a label? And what was it that kind of put you guys over? Do you remember at any point, you know, during your career that you guys really felt like, okay, well, now's the time that we really need to make this push? And, you know, were there any sacrifices that you had to make to get there? You know, because, I mean, we always say you got to grind it out, right?
Yep.
When was that? That was 2009. We did a bunch of showcases in Toronto for Roadrunner, and it wasn't like an instant, okay, we want to sign you guys. It was more of like a development type of thing where they'd give us constructive criticism. We'd take that, go back home, work out some things, work on our set, work on our live show. A few months later, we'd go back, invite those people out to come watch us play again. And they're like, wow, you guys really took notice of what we were telling you what to do, and like, yeah, well, we want to make this work and be a professional band.
Right.
So of course we're gonna take that criticism from the people who know, right?
Did you feel at any point during that? And the reason I ask this is because I know sometimes when bands showcase and there's a development deal, that you know, there's some level of compromise in the music. And did you guys ever feel at any point? I mean, I know your work is pretty heavy, right? Did you ever feel like there was a compromise there, in terms of some of that feedback, or you know, was it more just polishing?
Not musically, no. Actually, no. Across the board. I mean, when we started out, we were more of a progressive band, and as we played together for years, our sound kind of developed into more of a pop structure, but still really heavy, which is what I think caught the ears of a lot of people, because we would write actual choruses and verses and stuff like that.
Right.
Stuff that would stick into people's heads. And that wasn't anything that anybody told us to do. That was just a development of our own, like,
musicianship.
That's what we wanted to do.
Yeah, exactly. So if you when you listen back to some of your early stuff, comparatively speaking, to what you're doing now, do you find that it's is it a big departure, or is there a lot of similarities?
There are similarities. I think the main thing, the first recording we did, we had a very European sound. There was like synth in the background and
like Final Countdown,
like power metal sounding almost with the guitars, and now it's more of like a rock metal sound.
So people that have been following the band will know your history with respect to, you know, signing to a label and in terms of where you are now. So what are you guys up to these days? Like, what's in store for Baptized?
Right now we've been demoing new tunes, working on a new album. We've got probably about 8 tunes we're working on right now towards a new record. We're just I've actually set up a little recording station at home in the basement where we can demo stuff out ourselves, and actually have Alex come in and play the drums rather than programming them on a computer.
Right, right. Well, you're a sound guy too, right?
Yeah, yep.
So you got some background in that. So, mm-hmm. I mean, it's always great to be able to DIY your own stuff, right? Because then you can listen back and kind of figure out exactly what it is that you want to do, right?
Right.
But at the same time, from there, you've been recording with Aaron Murray in his studio?
We have, yep.
And he did your Gutterbound EP as well?
Yep. I've known Aaron since we were like 2 years old. We actually played in our first band together when we were 12.
Oh, nice.
So, I don't know.
What was it called?
The band?
Yeah.
It was called 12 Gauge. We started out as a Nirvana cover band. And then we just ripped off Nirvana.
Did you have Paul McCartney?
Who?
Did you know? Yeah.
Who's that?
Mom, yeah. So, let's check out a tune. You brought us some new stuff?
Yeah, I've got a new recording here of a brand new track. It's called Time to Die.
Well, you got the power.
Nobody's heard it, unless you've come to see us in the past couple of months.
I've heard it.
Tried to, man, but it was sold out.
All right, so this is some new unreleased Baptized in Blood here on the London Indie Underground.
We'll be right back. blood will never sustain this pressure. And this is all we deserve. A black mark on a bigger side. Knife in his back and a thorn in his side. Paint a picture I won't despise. Wake me up when it's time to die. Forgiven. You set yourself up and stop to pay the price. Step away from reconstructing bridges. You burn them all down, now you're dying inside. A black mark on a bigger sign. Knife in his back and a thorn in his side. Paint a picture I won't despise. Wake me up when it's time to die. When it's time to die. Inherently we're nihilistic creatures, tearing down the path of die unbelievers. Confessing sins upon deaf ears. I'm too far gone, I'm too far gone. Lay your head in the jaws of the lion. Voice fed the wrong and the fire. Lay your head in the jaws of the lion. Voice fed the wrong.
New Baptized in Blood here on the London Indie Underground. It was a great song.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I like the, I mean, certainly a lot of the familiar elements, because your sound is your sound, right? But I like some of the breakdowns, and, you know, there's a bit of space in there, which I think is new to my ears anyway.
Yeah, we've been kind of going the way of the groove lately, kind of slowing things down a little bit and getting heavier. I like it.
Who would you say are your big influences for you in your writing and your guitar playing and moreover in the band, as far as the band is concerned?
I think we've got a good mix of, like, there's definitely a Lamb of God influence.
Yeah, I hear
Pantera
that.
Pantera stuff.
Yeah.
But then there's, like, I'm a huge Van Halen fan, and Motley Crue, and old punk rock stuff like Strung Out. That's one of my favorite bands.
Right on.
So I think we tie all that into our sound pretty well.
Do the other members of the band share the same influences? Like, what was it music? Was it music that brought you together?
Nick, actually, how I just said, Aaron and I played in our first band together. Nick was in that band too. So him and I have been playing together since we were 12, basically. And we're all pretty like-minded with our musical taste, except for Shags. He just likes
Pig Destroyer.
Neurosis and black metal.
Yeah.
It was funny.
Antigone and Sarah. He likes right. Antigone and Sarah too.
I was gonna say it's funny because when you look at him, you think he was more of a fan of like the hippie movement, you know what I mean? Like, you know, that 60s, early 70s kind of stuff. You
oh,
know?
This is pretty much why we call him Shags.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Well, it's the look, right? Yeah. Not necessarily the influences.
Yeah, exactly.
So we were kind of talking offline here for a moment, and you know, one of the big things in the news here in the London market has been you know, this controversial vote that happened in city council for the removal of Jofo from power amidst
Jofo.
The charges or alleged, you know, wrongdoings. Because I mean, you know, he is innocent until he's proven guilty. Although I think the evidence is pretty damning, and at this point, maybe it's just a matter of time. But that kind of dovetails into what you guys did, and correct me if I'm wrong, but the FM96, the Battle of the New Rock, you guys were inducted into the Hall of Fame because of the recording that you did.
Hall of Famers.
Right.
Three times.
10 wins in a row gets you into the Hall of Fame.
Right. And it was for what song?
Right. Well, Jofo, that's a new one I've never heard before, but what he had this theme song for the City of London made that was called right. The City of Opportunity.
Right.
And
who was it?
I think it was Taz on the radio.
What was his name?
Said, oh, wouldn't it be hilarious if a death metal band did a cover of this? And we just so happened to be listening to the radio at that time. And Joel and I looked at each other and we're like, let's do it.
Jim Chapman, I think.
Jim Chapman, yeah.
Jim yes. Chapman did the original.
Yeah.
Which, you know, you could hear on like a commercial for London, you know, like a cheesy Rogers well, Cable 12 commercial.
Doesn't he do the commercial for the duty-free shop at the border?
Oh, does he? I don't know about that, but
pretty sure.
So you guys did your own rendition of this, and as a result, through fan voting, 10 weeks consecutively, you're entered into the FM96 Hall of Fame.
That's right. Like Aaron recorded this too. We did it over the course of 2 days, just a weekend.
I remember, I think they interviewed Aaron on the radio about this song.
Did they?
Yeah. Yeah, and about how it came to be. And he said, you guys showed up with a bunch of beer and pizza, and let's do her. And who knew that it would lead to this, right? So I think in the spirit of what's been happening, maybe we should check this song out.
Sure.
For a laugh. All right, so this is Baptized in Blood with London is a City of Opportunity. Oh, Edie.
I got it.
Didn't work.
Well, they
said
it
couldn't find the file.
Here.
He's got it. All right, here we go.
Coming on you.
Meow.
The closer you look, the more you see. London is the city of opportunity. Yeah!
Baptized in Blood with London is a City of Opportunity, the official song for London, Ontario, as voted by FM 96 voters. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can't argue with the Hall of Fame, right?
Can't. Nope. I don't that can never be taken away.
I don't have the original, but I wish I did so that I could contrast that between the other. I should do a bit of a mashup. That'd be great. So, do you guys perform that live?
We have.
You have?
We have once, yeah.
Just, obviously, in London?
Yep.
Yeah. And what was the reception?
Fucking wild.
I'm pretty sure I stage dove do it. Yeah. Dave stage dove for it and ate shit.
Yeah. His glasses held up, though. Yeah.
That's why they're broken now.
Did people, like, move out of the way? Like,
no, I just...
Parting in the sea?
Went. I was too drunk and just went to an area that didn't exist.
You ever see that, though? I've seen that shows before.
Yeah.
You
know, oh, yeah, people move. Just,
oh,
yeah.
This one time I was at the show. And this was in North Bay, and it was just like a hometown show. And people were losing it. There's a punk band called Brigati Rossi playing. And so this big dude gets up on stage and goes to stage dive. And as he jumps off, everybody gets out of the way, and the guy, like, bounced right off of hard concrete. It feels so bad for him. Yeah. It's hardcore, meow.
You'll never see that happen to a girl, though.
You will never.
No, you'll see many hands up at that point.
Of course.
Yep.
So we got Herbert. Some more baptized. I think Josh has one more unreleased track. Did you want to share with us, or did you want to dig into the archive maybe?
We could do that.
It's up to you. Well, let's talk about the video that you shot for Last Lying Lady, which you know, is available on YouTube right now. And I saw you guys had posted it recently as a bit of a reminder. But I watched that video, and it's amazing, man. The whole storyline behind that is very cool. Can you tell us a bit about that whole process? Because, I mean, it's a pretty elaborate video.
It's it's a really fun video to watch. I guess what's going on is you got this regular 9-to-5-er guy. He walks into a bar, orders a beer, sits down. There's a band playing in this shitty little dive. And classically, that's us. I don't know how to explain it. He passes out, has a dream that he's driving off a cliff, and he remembers that he bought our CD. So while he's soaring to his death, he puts the CD in. And just starts giving her in his car, opens the door, ends up standing on the back of the car as it's going straight down, fucking opens the gas cap up, lights her up, and he's just air guitaring, plummeting to his death.
So is this a dream sequence? Or is this...
You don't know this yet, right, until the end.
Right.
So the car crashes into the bar that he went to in the first place.
After a 4-minute fall.
Right. And then he wakes up, sees that he got this girl's phone number that he was hitting on earlier, looks down at the floor, and there's our CD that he bought, but it's on fire.
Dun, dun,
weird,
dun.
Rippy shit.
One of my favorite parts of the video, which, incidentally, we just posted up on our London Indie Underground Facebook page, if you'd like to check it out. Encourage you to do so, because it's pretty entertaining. One of my favorite parts is right at the beginning. You guys are doing the sound check, and the camera pans over to you. And it's like, you're looking around.
My retard,
like,
face?
No, well, no.
Sorry, my...
Don't worry, we can say retard. We said plenty worse.
Yeah, that's true.
No, but the look you had on your face was like, what the hell is this place? We're playing here? It was great.
But did you notice that Joel was wearing a Night Owl t-shirt?
I did. Should we talk about the Night
Rep
Owl?
Rep in London.
Definitely.
No, you're still talking about Josh.
Right. Well, I thought maybe you were trying to...
No.
Oh. Okay, got it. So, who directed this video for you?
It was Cody Callahan.
And was this Cody's concept, or was this the band's concept?
Yes, it was Cody's.
So there's a lot of miniature stuff in there, too, like...
Yeah, they spent... I think 2 or 3 weeks doing miniature filming, whatever you want to call it.
It was a pretty elaborate production.
Yeah, they did a lot of work behind the scenes on it, and then they only brought us in for like 8 hours.
Just for the live performance. It was totally awesome. Yeah, that's great. So the video that you did previously for it was for Dirty's Back, right?
Dirty's Back. Cody and his guys did that video as
well. He did that one as well. Now, the one that you just did, was this, did you guys apply for a grant or were you awarded anything to do it?
Yep. Yeah, we did the whole factor thing for it, and thank God, because it was up there.
Yeah, well, to do a video like that, I mean, you know, like I said, go check it out. You'll see exactly what we're talking about here. It's pretty impressive. But the previous video that you did, was that through the label? Was that something you guys did on your own as well?
That was through the label, Dirty's Back.
Yep. Okay. And that one, I'm sure it was a lot longer than 8 hours of performance.
That was actually my birthday when we did that.
Oh, really?
In this shitty abandoned meat packing factory, or wasn't it?
Yep.
Where?
Toronto.
In some industrial area of Toronto. And that was like a 16 or 17 hour day. We were all sick by the end of it.
I'm trying to crack open this track. I'm going to have to ask you to play it for us. Bear with me here for a moment. Ed just shared a couple of tracks with me
on
a
jump track.
It could very well be. I'm hoping, no disrespect, I'm hoping it is, and I'm hoping it's not my computer here because I got a lot of stuff on here.
I know computer problems.
Yes, you do. I know all about them. So we might as well spin this track.
Last Line Lady?
Yeah.
All right,
this is Last Line Lady, Baptized in Blood.
Coming on you.
The London Indie Underground.
Coming on your way, meow.
Coming on you, meow.
Just give it a shot, give it an extra minute. Before I forget what I want to back it up. Give me an extra minute. Before I know it, I'll be still complete the fall. Throw me a line, throw me a last line lead. Let's remember why we started to stress it up. Throw me a last look hard.
Baptized in Blood. Last line lady here on the London Indie Underground. Got a couple messages from a few of our listeners. You know, I know it's a bit heavy tonight. We're delving into a bit of the heavier catalog. But, you know, our podcast here wants to showcase some of our finest artists in the area.
Mm-hmm.
And very lucky to have a member of Baptized in Blood with us today. Thanks, Josh, for coming. We really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Anytime, man. Anytime. It's open door. And we encourage any of our previous guests, anytime you'd like to come down here on a Wednesday. We got AJ sitting on the couch.
Open door, open fridge.
Yep. Open door, open fridge. Absolutely.
Which you told me was clean.
Well, it
was.
And
then I opened it up, and it spilled all over me.
It's because your glasses weren't on.
Well, yeah. I can't see shit, but...
Don't blame my fridge, man. You cleaned up today, man. I did. Well, I stacked the beers all nicely, because there was a bunch left over from the podcast.
Not complaining about the mess. I'm happy that it's full.
Yeah. Did they all fall on your head?
No.
First world problems.
That was a short joke. That was a short joke.
He said he stacked them up. Edie was up on his tippy toes. And they all came crashing down on him.
So, we should talk a little bit about the owl, about the bird. I know there was a bunch of changes that happened there, and we had talked about it previously. But I guess everything's done. The renovations are complete, are they?
Phase one of the renovations are complete. We start, they're closed again this Sunday, and then it will be finished by Tuesday and open prior for good.
And they got some good-looking staff there. Some good-looking fucking staff.
For some reason, we hired this guy named AJ from Two Crown King, and I don't get why. But, he works there.
Yeah, he's
so he'll he'll serve your turducken at the early bird. And
at 3:30 a.m.
Oh, yeah, those are the best, man. Those are the best shifts. I'm not even kidding you. I'm going to tell them, actually, I'm working
in the day tomorrow, and I'm gonna be like, look, the night shifts are where it's at. Just more fun.
So you're going to tell them to leave and then come back later?
No. I'm going to tell them. Jen, I'll be like, hey, because I said I got my first couple of night shifts this weekend, so I'll let you know which one I like better. So I don't know which one I like better.
So they knocked out. I haven't been there since the renovations. I wanted to go this past Sunday. I haven't been.
Maybe for some reason I thought you were there with us on Friday night, but
Friday too.
Yeah,
was I there? No, I wasn't there Friday.
I'm almost positive that you were there on Friday night.
Friday night.
I could be wrong.
No. If I was.
We're all...
I thought...
I know.
No,
I'm pretty...
No, I wasn't.
I could have sworn you were there. Sorry, what were you going to say?
What actually did they do?
Yeah, what did they do?
Oh, so the Night Owl half itself is now... I don't even know how to describe this with words. You kind of have to go in and see. Basically, there is a half retaining wall kind of dividing the Night Owl, but really not. So now it's a bunch of lovely seats, you know, all around. The DJ booth at the front is gone. The stage is still there, but it's a booth. We won't really be doing a lot of bands anymore, maybe some acoustic acts here and there. Just for those who know the backstory involving the city and the complications that they, you know, brought up for us. Whatever. Basically, it's now this nice little cozy New York-style hole-in-the-wall bourbon bar, where you can still go and get your $4 Pabst cans and hang out, but it's just a lot more chill. It's a lot more inviting.
Definitely.
Yeah. So what they're going to do this Sunday is the bar gets cut down in half, because, the bar there was absolutely atrociously huge for no reason and way far out, so now it's getting kind of tucked in, pushed back. Open up the room a whole lot more. You know, there's going to be a nice little DJ booth constructed out of old speaker boxes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, you got to go in there and see it. It's
awesome.
I think it's awesome. I mean, it's obviously when the whole thing came up, it was a huge bummer to me initially. But now
it's
that I've gotten
better to
see it, and you know, it's a really good thing.
The bar was that size because of the city as well.
Yeah.
Was it not?
Yeah. So this is the thing I don't understand. When the Wolf Brothers were constructing the bar, and everyone was always complaining about how far it was pushed out of the room. And if you've been to the Owl, you know there's a very narrow walkway from the bar
to
the wall to where you get to the washroom, and you literally have to elbow your way 4 deep. So the reason that is because the bar needs to be, I think it was 4.5, the space between the back wall and your coolers needs to be 4.5 feet, I think it was, maybe, for wheelchair access, which I understand. I mean, I'm no discrimination whatsoever. But what I don't understand, though, is that people who are in a wheelchair are usually sitting, you know, a little lower than a person standing. So why does the bar need to be 5 feet out?
Oh, man.
But not that 5 feet lower.
Lower. Yeah.
So I'm, you could literally get the employee back there, but he wouldn't be able to reach the bar. Yeah. I just did that, too. So, that bylaw, I just don't understand. It took me a while to wrap my head around that.
Yeah.
But now that we're over that, you know, it's going to be good. Back to original hours. The bar is going to be open actually every day from 5 o'clock till 2 now. So after work, you can go in, grab some pints, grab some bourbon, sit down.
So this Sunday they're closed?
This Sunday we're closed. Okay. Hopefully open again on Tuesday for music trivia, which should be going. And then every Thursday, vinyl night's still on, so come awesome. Down, drink some beers. Bring your own vinyl. Justin Chasty from Grooves Records and CHW. You know, you can playlist your own night while you hang out.
Spins the best yet.
And then on Saturdays, it's Howl at the Owl, which is all like Motown, funk, garage rock, cool stuff to listen to. And then I DJ every Sunday still.
So you are still DJing.
That's I am still DJing on Sundays, yeah. It's not Big Shiny Sundays anymore. I don't want to loop myself into some kind of night. So I'm kind of all over the map by playing, you know.
You're all over the map anyway.
What, I'm always over the map.
Yeah.
And I mean, that's the thing, is you stick me on a night where it's a format, and by, 12:30, after I've had about 13 tall cans and 26
Africa
Jaggers.
And
a lot of Gowan and a lot of Toto. Peter Gabriel.
You played an awesome Gowan cover by
NWOG. NWOG. I brought you from the other day.
Yeah. I was impressed.
Have you heard? You did hear that, eh?
Well, I was there. Were you there that day?
Friday? No, I wasn't, actually.
Sunday. No, were you there Sunday?
No.
Regardless, check out the Night Owl and the Early Bird.
Yeah.
Good food, good beers, good people.
Amazing service.
Yeah.
How did that...
tip heavily.
So You Should Eat Here, the feature that they did.
You gotta eat here.
You gotta eat here. You should.
Although,
eat here.
One day I typoed on my phone. Like, I handle all the social media for the Night Owl and the Early Bird. And I was putting some plug in. And I can't remember what I said, but it was like, you gotta be here. I was like, you gotta be here for the taping of You Gotta Be Here.
The famous Edie autocorrect posts.
Yeah. I need a proofreader. If anyone wants a job, I can't pay you because I have to go fix my glasses.
Yeah, you definitely need a proofreader now. Might as well just get a stenographer? Or
yeah.
I talk a lot, though, and it's, I mumble, too, so I don't know if they'd be able to appreciate that. So you were going to say, how did the You Gotta Eat Here come about, right?
Right.
Well, basically, the show is really cool. It's run by viewer. What's the word I'm looking for? Referrals? No.
Okay.
Recommendations.
Recommendations. Thank you. So a bunch of people will write in to the show about, you know, what's so special about the restaurant, how good the food is, how the atmosphere, the service is. And if they compile up enough, then they get stoked. We were glad to be a part after HUD being open for only 6 months. They came down, filmed for 2 days. John Cattucci was a riot.
What did they eat?
They ate the turducken.
Of course they did.
They did the bacon wrap pickles. They did the...
did they do the stacker?
They did the pancake stacker. They did the pierogi poutine.
Oh.
And it's then great. After the end, yeah, after all the shooting were done and they were actually eating their meal, they all did shots of our gravy, or shots of Chef Justin's gravy.
Shots?
They only did four dishes?
Well, they did four features. Like,
four features?
So
well, those are the features.
But
I meant,
they brought up a bunch of others. Like
right.
They did the Italian and whatever else. But, you know, if you've watched the show, they go into the kitchen and you make it and whatever. So, yeah, it's cool. It's good. So that's... Season starts in January, I believe, and I think we're the third episode.
They said sometime in February, March it's going to be run. They don't know exactly
maybe
the
date.
I was going to ask that. Now, as a result of the renovations, they're able to take reservations now. Is that correct?
Yes. Slowly.
Okay.
Starting to take place once again after the renovations are completely done. And there will be able to do reservations. So, yeah.
It's great.
It's a whole other 28 seats.
Listen, if you've not eaten at the Early Bird, you definitely need to go check this place out. It's kind of a hidden little gem in London, although it's starting to blow up. And from what I understand now, There's a lot more traffic coming through, and they're able to accommodate a lot more patrons now.
Oh, absolutely.
Which is
I get people coming in who are there strictly because it was in the paper and they heard about the show, and it's I get people saying, "What did that guy order?" And
right.
Boom.
Not to mention that we're on the London Indie Underground, and the restaurant was started by two guys from London bands.
Yeah,
exactly.
Justin, who was the singer of Thine Eyes Bleed,
you know,
and even before then, Acacia.
Mm-hmm. And that poster that was hanging up there when they played with Slayer.
Dude, they toured with
Lamb
them.
Of God.
Yeah, and it was Lamb one of the best tours I've ever seen.
And Mastodon.
I saw Acacia play in L.A. When I lived in L.A., yeah. They came by. They were opening for Kitty, and I remember because Luke was playing with them, and I used to work with Luke at the guitar shop. And it was awesome to, you know, be away for a year and a bit and then have some, you know, hometown guys come by and play the Whiskey.
Yeah.
And then I got to hang out backstage at the Whiskey and not only see Acacia play, but see Kitty play at the Whiskey and hang out backstage at the Whiskey. It was awesome.
It was great. Check it out. Early Bird, which is Talbot Street.
353 Talbot.
353
Talbot. Actually, the Early Bird is 355 Talbot.
355.
Night Owl is 353 Talbot, right across from John the Bat Center.
And Greg played in St. Clair, which...
Greg was in St. Clair, and now
they... will be playing, right?
Well...
No?
I've been trying to get that reunion together for, four years.
I thought that was really? Confirmed.
A couple of them are in.
Oh, shit. Sorry, man. I was looking forward to it, because they're doing the weekend, right?
That's it.
Yes, we are trying to get a St. Clair reunion going.
That'd be pretty awesome. Beards of Prey, though, right?
Yes. So they are also ran a line of band called Beards of Prey.
Awesome name.
And they will be playing with Baptized on December 21st in Stratford and December 22nd in Toronto at the Bovine.
Next week on London Indie Underground, we're going to be joined by Archie Gamble. And we're also going to be featuring the Christmas with the Salads and Friends, which features a couple of tracks from London bands, including Beards of Prey.
Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
Which is a fantastic rendition. We did play it on our Saturday podcast leading into the live performance. We had some of the CD that was playing in the background there. You might have caught some of it. But if not, we'll be featuring it for you next week. And it's a great mashup of bands on there and some great, a lot of creative license. And a lot of great takes on some old Christmas classics. So we're looking forward to sharing that with you. Cool. Broadcasting you live from the Vault Recording Studio, Adelaide and Princess. Joined today by co-host Gary Begner, Brandon Meady, Josh Torrance, Ajay Massey, who took over the microphone. And sitting on the corner over here. Sorry, that wasn't a hint, by the way. I'm just saying. And sitting over here to Mr. Jason Rorda, has been working away, uploading some photos from our podcast that happened this past Saturday with the Creekside Strays. He made a nice little Christmas card for us. Thank you, buddy. I appreciate that. So, I think it's time that we play this thing. So, Sarah Burke, as we said off the top, was supposed to join us today, and she called in sick. I know on Monday she wasn't feeling too well. And
I would say something about it, but
she
I got called
ripped
sick
pretty hard
week.
On FM 96, and she was going to come in today. So, she sent me this email and said that she had recorded this from bed. So, let's see what she has to say.
Hey, it's Sarah sitting in my pajamas. Instead of being with Edie, Josh Torrance from Baptized, and Jimmy at the Vault tonight for another London Indie Underground indie stream, I'm sorry, I haven't been feeling so hot, so I just wanted to say hi from the comfort of my own bed. I also wanted to tell you what my jammies look like tonight. They are bright red with cute little cartoon dogs on them. Got them for Hanukkah last year. And, I think we're going to be doing a new podcast in the new year involving one of the people sitting in that room at the Vault right now. I will leave it to the boys to give you all the details. From my bed, this is Sarah Burke signing off. Bye.
Thanks, Sarah.
I'll be here. So
lovely, there you lovely go. Description of her pajamas, because, you know, our listeners wanted to know that kind of stuff.
AJ was what curious say, if they were crotchless.
So it's no mystery. We've been trying to book a date here with Baptized, and we went back and forth with a couple of dates that Sarah was at a wedding on one of those weekends and wouldn't work. But hopefully we can put something together here in the new year. We got a lot of stuff coming up in January, including a Staylefish podcast for the album premiere and release. We're going to be doing a live performance, so we'll be making some dates as we hammer out some dates for you. But a lot coming in the new year. We've got some exciting guests that are going to be happening in January, in addition to some live performances during our weekly indie stream on Wednesday nights. We're going to be featuring as part of the Indie Spotlight band performances here from the studio, acoustic and otherwise. And we have a couple announcements that are going to be happening. I've confirmed one band so far, and another one that I'm going to be confirming after this weekend, which I'm very excited to share with you guys. So stay tuned. we will let you know. Gary, you look like you have something you need to say.
I have nothing to say. I'm just sitting here.
Trying to avoid my burps.
Yeah, pretty much so. I'm kind of using the filter on my mic to kind of like make sure I'm not inhaling anything else.
All right, so we should probably get to some music here. So I know we've been spinning some of the heavier stuff tonight, and I love the heavy stuff, but you know, maybe we'll break it down a little bit here. And I do have some new Staylefish that I'll spin for you. Because, you know, I can do that.
All and 163 tracks of it.
Well, not that one. I would love to play that one today, but I've got to finish up the mix. I was, to be honest with you, I was having a bit of problem with automation this afternoon. You might have saw my post on Facebook. If you don't know what automation is, it fucking sucks.
It beat you.
So it'll get you. So let's check this out. Actually, we'll spin the first single that we featured a while back. This is Staylefish with All Around the World on the London Indie Underground.
Crazy economy.
Staylefish with All Around the World here on the London Indie Underground. Keep an eye out for our album premiere podcast featuring Sarah Burke, which will be coming at you within the next week. We will be broadcasting it live, in all likelihood after our indie stream. However, we will be uploading it and archiving to our Ustream, our YouTube account, which is where we archive all of our existing stuff. If you'd like to check it out, youtube.com/LondonIndieUG. You can check out our 13 previous streams. We've had some great guests on our show and great sampling of some of London's finest musicians, so I encourage you to go and check it out. So, what do we talk about now? It's kind of this is open forum time, so I'm going to leave
open
it to you.
Open mic?
Open mic time. Ian Gifford wanted me to tell you that you're blowing eardrums.
Well, I was talking louder because I knew he was listening, and I wasn't sure if his hearing aid was turned on.
What would Ian? What would Ian do in this situation?
Right now?
Yeah.
Ian, how many beers deep are you right now? Because tell me, and I'll get that many beers deep, and then we'll see what you do.
Well, so far, when Ian's here, usually he takes his shirt off at some point.
Right.
So.
It's true.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, you... I'm not even going to call you that.
Just put a compressor on Edie's mic.
I really should. No, it's all good. We
I'll stand back here, okay?
No, I'm just kidding, man. I'm just kidding. It's no big deal. You can be loud.
You came to the party late anyway.
I can't see where the microphone is.
Like you, Ian needs some glasses, too. Ian, get some glasses. There's an inside joke there, but that I won't repeat.
But fuck it, $5.
But yeah. Fuck it. $5. So Ian's rolling with this thing. So okay, so I'm gonna out him on this whole thing. So you know, I told the story a couple of weeks back about Crazy Uncle Contraband's fucking $5, and that where the story came from was a friend of mine who worked in, you know, for a shipping company. Well, that friend is Ian Gifford. And one day somebody came in and had a suspicious package that Ian had to phone in because he suspected that it could be drugs or whatever. And, you know, when he said, you know, it's contraband, it was very emphatic, like, it's contraband. So we started calling him Contraband, and then he was Crazy Uncle Contraband, because, you know, he's crazy. And then, you know, it grew into Crazy Uncle Contraband's fucking $5. So starting in January, we're going to be doing a promo. I don't know if you heard the jingle that I wrote for it, which is pretty ridiculous. But we've asked bands that if you're interested.
Hey, motherfucker, you're down on your luck.
Oh, yeah, do you want to hear it? Oh, I recorded a new version. It's like King of the Hill style. Yeah. Serious. So, you know, what's funny is that at first Ian didn't want to embrace the whole Crazy Uncle Contraband persona whatsoever. He was like, no, I'm not feeling it. You know, I don't want to be known as that guy, you know, whatever. And now, I mean, he sent me like 30 texts today on different marketing ideas and, you know, how he can, he's like, well, if somebody signs up for London Indie Underground, I can cut them a personalized promo that says, hey, this is Crazy Uncle Contraband. Thanks for signing up for London Indie Underground. Now go bang a raccoon or something. I don't know. Seriously.
Go bang a raccoon?
No, it probably said go fuck a ferret, I think is what it said. I can pull it up here.
So what you're saying is he's starting to enjoy the...
Oh, yeah. He's liking this...
Yo, motherfuckers, it's Crazy Uncle Contraband. You want some weed?
It's Contraband. Hold on, I'm going to pull it up here because I want to see what he said. Hopefully I don't embarrass him. All right, so what he said... Oh, yeah. Hello, Bart. This is Crazy Uncle Contraband. Thanks for joining London Indie Underground. Now go fuck a gazelle. Right, so that, you know, that's the kind of messaging
that
I...
Can we throw that idea in the garbage?
Yeah, it's the kind of messaging I want to give to our followers on London in the Underground. I don't know about that. If anything, I'd want to say, you know, thank you, here's a beer. Hang out for a while.
No, go buy a monkey.
Yeah.
Leave it in the parking lot.
IKEA monkey. So, yeah, here you go. So there's two of them. And then, Crazy Uncle Contraband's fucking $5. So that's a tribute to you, Ian Gifford. But we want to parlay this into something not just ridiculous, but something that can help bands get music into, you know, some new ears. And what we're going to be doing in the new year, and we've asked bands and extended an offer to them, if you'd like to have your music made available here at the recording studio, for our open door when we have our weekly indie streams in addition to our monthly podcasts. We're going to have music that's made available for $5. And, you know, we're not certainly not asking people to, or bands rather, to devalue their music, but we want to make it affordable. I know oftentimes bands want to give away their music for free, and we can respect that. But having said that, at the same time, you know, you spend all that time and effort and money into, you know, forming your songs, the production, the recording, your promo, the whole bit, right? So, you know, at some level, you need to be compensated for that. And even if it's $5, you know, that can add up, but I think it's more of a token gesture than anything else. So if you happen to want to showcase your music and make it available here at the studio, we're glad to represent it for you as part of Crazy Uncle Contraband's fucking $5 promo, which is a ridiculous promo, but who knows? Who knows where I could go? We'll see. So we're going to get to some more music here. I'm going to dig into the archives. So you guys talk amongst yourselves while I dig deep.
Oh, you're digging archives deep. You
got? I'm digging deep.
Are you saying fucking $5 or fuck it, funky?
Fuck it.
Fuck it.
Fuck it.
Basically, it's a piece of joint originally, and it was like, man, I don't got. Well, fuck it, $5. Yeah. That was a special.
If the guy can't order it quick enough, it's like, fuck it, $5.
Yeah, well, that was the whole promo. Is it a pizza joint? And if you called into this pizza joint, then as many toppings as you could rattle off before we hung up on you is how many you would get, right? So if you could rattle off 10, 15 toppings. In what, you know, let's say it was 30 seconds to get your order in, that's how many you would get. But if you were screwing around and you were like, yeah, I got the pizza place on the phone, and you know, then we'd hang up on you and we'd just deliver dough.
So, do you have sun-dried tomatoes? No, fuck.
Yeah.
Fucking $5. Yeah, click. So, what, I get sauce?
And we just hang up on you.
Fuck.
That's how we roll.
I just go to the early bird to get a turducken.
Man, that thing is a chore to eat.
I've killed one.
Yeah.
One with the side, and I've done smoked meat. I want to try the pancake stacker.
I want to try to kill the pancake
stacker. So every Friday is wing night there. And this sounds like such, you know, promo and plugs for it, which I guess in a way it kind of is. But no, this is the story of mammoth eating. So every Friday is wing night. So you get a pound of the house wings, and the plate is massive. I went in there, and I didn't even finish five. Like, I ate 5 1/4 of a plate, and I took it home. So this guy walks in for his first time, and he orders a turducken with a poutine.
Like a side poutine,
and then the order of the wing special. And I'm like, I look over to Jen, I'm like, has this guy ever been here? Like, does he order really realize what he's eating? And she's like, no, I don't think so. I was like, okay. I come in the next morning, I'm like, how'd that guy do? She's like, I have never seen somebody eat two of those plates side by side. I was like, he ate a turducken, a full poutine, another fry, and 12 fucking wings. Holy in one sitting for dinner, I was like, shit. How do you do that?
That's amazing, man. He should be awarded like a little trophy or something.
The turducken. Yeah, the golden turducken.
Yeah.
His bill.
he left a trophy behind.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to spin a band. You guys are familiar with Terrorhorse?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. No.
No.
Cam lived with us.
Oh, he did?
Yes, at one point. He ate my fucking food.
Cam eats everybody's food.
I don't know the story of that, but
I was really looking forward to those pizza pockets.
Pockets. All right, so we're going to check out a track here. Terrorhorse, this is Rapid Eye Movement on the London Indie Underground. Pockets.
Extracted from
Terrorhorse here on the London Indie Underground. Bit of a heavier number. Pretty sure my mom tuned out on that one. But and we're just kind of talking offline. And man, there's no way I could sustain that type of drum pattern for that extended period of time. I'd literally be a puddle.
It's that Panic Pony double kick.
Yeah, it's crazy, man. So I'm more of a fan of, like, I play in the pocket, right? So, like, you know, I'm playing with Two Crown now, and I'm, that's kind of a different style. But for me, you know, I grew up on Helmet. That was my thing, right? It was all straight groove. And we had talked about this before, Josh.
Yeah.
And we both kind of come from that that school of thought.
Loving some Helmet.
Absolutely. I'm trying to put together, and I've been talking about doing a Helmet tribute CD and getting some bands to contribute to this and see if they'd be interested in it. Because nowadays, it seems like the thing to do. There's all these tributes that are popping up. You know, I saw one to Beastie Boys not all that long ago. I mean, obviously, because of MCA's death, but there's been a number of other ones that are popping up, and I'm thinking to myself, man, why not? Why the heck not? People like Helmet? You want to record? Let me know. Sure. Get at me. Let's do this.
People like what they like, right?
So that's true.
That's right.
If you're going to do a Taylor Swift cover album, I'd get on that.
Ever.
Would you really?
I still want somebody to match that song up with Outkast. Never ever getting back together. Never ever 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 getting back together.
All right. So we reached the end.
Play something.
Another podcast. I'm going to play another song here.
I guess it is.
But I do need to take a minute to thank our sponsors, as always. And today we'll start off with Jay Rorta Photography. Jason, thanks again for coming down weekly. We always appreciate you taking time out of your schedule to come down and make us look fat. Boy, especially nice. Gary.
Yeah. Yep. Skinniest fat man alive.
Yeah, and for coming down.
He doesn't look bad this week.
No?
It's because I've been working out.
Yeah. Really?
What about last week?
Working your neck out.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Stephen Hawking's thing is over. Damn.
So thanks for coming in on Saturday, too. And like I said, he's posting up the pictures from the podcast with the Creekside Strays, the Ugly Christmas Sweater Party. So you can certainly go and check him out now.
Exactly.
In all our ugly splendor. But it was a great time. And Jason, week to week, has been coming out here. And we really appreciate it. From now until the end of the year, which is not long, he does have a promo, $50, and he will come out and do some photos for you, for your band, for your glamour shots, take some pictures of your kids, if you want some pictures of your food, whatever the case may be.
Deer in a field.
Yeah, $50 now until the end of the year. Got out a professionally trained photographer that knows how to make you look good.
Perhaps you're going to the Night Owl. You want to get yourself some pictures taken of you, you know, eating some food.
Yeah.
Partying down, perhaps.
Yeah.
Jay will just cover. Paparazzi Jay. There you go.
He's like walking Instagram. But it's not instant.
No.
Because you got to wait until he gets
crop
access to internet.
Edit it a bit.
Yeah. Goes to Williams good. Coffee Pub. And
yeah. Just a walking gram.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. Make Gary look like Stephen Hawking.
Good job.
Delay-a-gram.
All right. I also need to thank the Submission Academy, my good friend Gene, and Steve Poulin. I've talked about this in previous weeks, and, you know, I really pump in their tires. Up until recently, Stephen was a postman and working as a postman full time, and, you know, which is a career job, you know, with great benefits and, you know, the whole bit. And his school has blown up to the point now where he's actually left his career to focus strictly on teaching jiu-jitsu. His kids program is blowing up. They recently competed in Grappler's Quest. They walked away with 5 gold medals, 3 bronze, and a silver, and one of those being the North American champion in blue belt division. So obviously a great representation from the Submission Academy. And, you know, if you happen to be looking for, you know, a fun and neat way to get in shape and to build confidence through, you know, through hard work, then these are the people that you want to go see. They'll tailor the program to you. The first class is free. Go and check them out. Some fantastic people with a fantastic school. Love them. Thank you very much, guys. And they're, you know, something to be said for good karma. You know, when people do things for you, you want to return it in spades, right? And there's no question that these two have really done a lot for me in the past, and I'm more than happy to pay it forward. Thank you. Want to thank Scotty Finlayson at Full Color Cards, otherwise known as Scotty Fairmont. Plays around town in a band called the Fairmonts. You've probably seen them before if you've been to the Poach, which they frequent. He's a good dude. Broke away from working for the man. Now he's working for himself. doing his own things, making his own cards, and doing a great job. Hooked us up here at the London Indie Underground.
Posters, postcards.
Yeah.
You name it, does it all.
Yeah, he does graphics, graphic design. Cards is his forte right now and what he's focusing on. However, if you do need graphics done, believe me, he's a wizard. Certainly a good guy to see. And last but not least, Gary and Shirt for Brains, who's printed some shirts up here for London Indie Underground. He brought us another batch. Thank you very much.
No problem.
Although I'm still waiting
for the Merkin shirt.
Show me your Merkin shirt. I need to see this thing. I want to wear it, man. I will, believe me, I will support this for you. And I will tell everybody that Gary Begner made this shirt.
That the kids at Shirt for Brains made me show me your Merkin shirt.
Right.
T-shirt.
Right. So
we got to come up with a Merkin flag.
A Merkin.
Yeah, the Merkin flag. Just remove the stars and put in little, like, clumpy Vs.
Do you guys you know what a Merkin is?
Just Merkin, like America without the A?
No.
No, it's
a Merkin, M-E-R-K-I-N.
It's a pubic. It's M-E-R-K-I-N, no. Yeah. And it's a pubic wig that they used to wear back in Shakespeare times, so when men played
pubic
women
wig
on stage, they would have the patch. And, yeah. And they still do them today.
Yeah.
You can buy them on eBay, sadly.
You know what's funny? You ever watch the show Californication?
Yes.
Yeah.
So one of the, I think during season two, and it's Runkle, he's dating the porn star. And so she's on the set of, I can't remember the name of the movie. It was pretty ridiculous. But anyway, she comes out and she's prepared for the shot. And I guess she's all clean, shaven.
Right.
And, you know, the director starts giving her hell. And then they call out to get a Merkin for her, which I thought was hilarious.
Based on our conversations.
So we'll hopefully we get that shirt. If we do, we'll make sure to take some photos so you can check it out. Because believe me, that was a very taboo conversation. However, you know, certainly spurred a lot of activity on our feed and a lot of interest in that.
Okay.
So Siggy Meyer, if you happen to be listening, please come because we're not going to get these shirts until you show up.
I was holding out for Siggy because he was part of the conversation. So.
All right. Well, that brings us to the end. So.
Merkins.
Yep. So I just want to thank you two for coming again, Brendan Eady and Josh Torrance. Really
thank
appreciate
you guys
for
having us.
No, you're more than welcome anytime.
So long, and thanks for the shoes.
Well, obviously, we'll see you again next time with some new glasses, maybe.
The unbreakable kind?
Yeah, a monocle.
Maybe.
A
monocle. Yeah. Well, I was wearing them like this earlier. People can't see this. It was not funny.
That's hilarious.
Yeah. I'd love to come back.
Yeah, please do. I want
to drink your beer at any time.
Absolutely. It's not my beer.
It was sponsored beer.
Thank you, Paps.
More than welcome to drink it.
You sponsor my life.
And Josh, if you have any more songs that are coming down the pipe too, please make sure to get them into our hands. We'd be happy to feature for you.
You betcha.
And then when you guys get close to, you know, whenever you're doing a release or whatever the case may be, we'd be happy to support you. Do another indie spotlight.
Come hang out again. Play some tunes.
Love to.
Drink some beers.
Yeah. Haul anybody else that you can with you.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
Can you do me one favor before we leave?
Certainly can.
Can we please play that clip of the girl queefing on command again?
Do you have it?
Oh, man.
Okay, we can. So we will end with this. How about that?
Finishing the show with a queef.
Good night.
We got to wait. He's pulling it up. Actually, if you grab his end.
Yeah, grab
the business
end.
Just make sure your volume's all the way up.
Ready?
Ready. Hold on. Go.
One more. One last one. I didn't get that.
Love you,
one.
Scott.
One
You're my best friend ever. No, I'm completely...
Hold on.
I never got the flu shot.
Clear it out. Do it up.
It's gone.
One last one.
No, you're videotaping.
Your face is not in it. I need proof of this.
Really?
I swear. No one will believe me.
Not happening.
I missed it.
I've heard it like four times now.
All right, listen.
Is that real?
Yeah.
That was real.
That was real.
All she does is this.
Wow.
And that.
And on that note, we're
that's
out.
Going out on a high note?
Yes.
Okay.
So thanks for tuning in to another edition of the London Indie Underground. We appreciate, I know today we had some new listeners. Check back with us next week where our guest will be Archie Gamble. And we'll be featuring a bunch of new bands that you haven't heard before, as well as some bands that you might be familiar with. And who knows where the conversation is going to go. Maybe we'll even try to get Queefer Sutherland as a guest.
I'm working on it.
Queefer Sutherland.
Oh, beautiful.
All right. Good night, everybody. Thank
Later.
You.
Later.
Bye.